Hi, my name is Jared, and in this bootcamp tutorial, you're going to learn about the 250 EMA universe. This is a very popular way of selecting a universe of stocks to trade that's based on the 200 EMA and the 50 EMA crossing. So in this tutorial, you're going to learn how to use a technical indicator on a universe and then how to tidy up that code by using a class to group those indicators together. Then we're going to use the history call to warm up our class and get those indicators ready to trade quickly. So let's get started. So for the first task, we need to prepare our universe for trading. The most basic part of this is simply select a course universe of stocks and then allocate our portfolio equally to those stocks that we've selected. Later on in the bootcamp tutorial, we're going to go over about inserting the indicators and updating the history, but first let's lay our foundations. So with this objective, we need to sort the course object that's coming in from our universe selection and then get the highest volume stocks. So we can borrow some of this. So here you can see we've used the sorted function on our course object and sorted by dollar volume so that we can get a sorted list of these course objects. So here it's asking us to take all of the stocks which are greater than $10 and then save that list to the selected property. And then finally, we're going to return that as the result of our universe. So you can notice here that we're using the price property of the course object. We're checking to make sure it's greater than $10. And then we're only taking the top 10 that match that filter. So then here, and our on securities changed, once we've selected those assets and they're added to the algorithm, we can allocate our portfolio to those assets equally. So first, before we increase our position, we need to liquidate. Only the removing securities. And then just like shown here, we can allocate 10% of our portfolio to any security that's coming into our universe. So if you notice here, you'll remember this from previous tutorials, it's important to liquidate before you increase your positions in other assets to make sure you don't have any buying power issues. So we're liquidating our symbols here, and then when symbols get added, we're setting our portfolio to 10% of those. So let's see how we go. Okay, awesome. On to the next task. So if you ever want to use indicators or multiple properties with a specific security, it can be helpful to group all of those data objects together using a class. There are many ways of doing this, but this using a class maintains a nice separation of concerns. Separation of concerns is a programming concept we like to encourage, where you have a dedicated class or a dedicated piece of code that's assigned to updating and maintaining and curating itself. So here we're going to create a class called selection data, and it's going to be responsible for holding the indicators and keeping them updated. So here is our selection data class. You can see a few examples. And we need to create this task. So we're using 50 and 200 EMAs here. So let's create our EMAs here. So if you remember, the 200 is the longer period for the EMA. So we'll call that one the slow one. And the 50 is the faster EMA because it's getting updated more quickly. Okay, and then number three, we need to create a property called isReady. And this is a nice way to group all of our indicators together so we can check if they're all ready before we use them. So with Python, we can do that with a nice method that we'll call isReady. And we need to return if our slow and our fast indicators are ready. So technically, what you could do here is do if slow is ready and fast is ready. But the slow indicator takes 200 data points to be ready, and the fast indicator takes 50. So as a shortcut, it's only got the one property here, but we'll leave it as two for nice code cleanliness. And we should always pass in the self here. And number three is done. Okay, so now we've got two indicators that both need to be updated with new price data as it arrives in our algorithm. So let's create a method which takes that price data to update and applies it to the indicators in the class. So we can use this example here. So you can see here we've created a new method, update, that takes a time and a price. And this is what we need to update our indicators. So we pass that time and price into our indicators inside the class. Okay, let's see how it goes. Okay, seems like our class is compiled, and now we're able to try and use that class inside of our universe. So first we're going to create a dictionary to hold all of those averages and an instance of each of those classes that we've just created. So let's create that property. And now, every time that we find a new company which isn't in our averages collection, we're going to go and create a new instance of that class and add it to our collection. So, let's see here, if the symbol is not in averages, let's create a new one and save it to the averages dictionary. Okay, so the symbol is not in the averages, we've created it, and now we need to access that and then update it with a time and adjusted price of the data. So we have an instance of that class inside averages. So let's access it here. We can see here symbol is equal to the core symbol, the company. So let's access that and then call update. So even though this is a dictionary with a key, each one of these items in the dictionary is one of our class. So you can see here we have the update and the time and the price. So what time and what price should we pass in to update these indicators? Thankfully, on the course object, we have this adjusted price property. So we can use that as the price. And then for the time, we can probably use the algorithm time. We go, self.time. So you can see here that this is an instance of QC algorithm, and so because it's on the algorithm, we still have access to the time object. So this is the current time of the algorithm. So we pass those two in, and it's going to update this selection data object. So one thing, key thing to note is that universes prices move and change over time, and there's a lot of splits and dividends that are applied to those securities. So you should probably use the adjusted price when you're working with indicators, because then all of those splits and dividends have been factored in, and you won't get any price discontinuities when you work with indicators and universes. So now finally, let's do number five. Let's check to see if the fast is greater than the slow. EMA. So we can do that using the example code here. So in our dictionary for that company, if the fast indicator is greater than the slow indicator and the indicators are ready to use, then we need to add them to this selected collection, which will then be returned as the universe. So selected is defined up here for us, and it's the collection of stocks which we're going to be returning. So we're adding those to this internal list and then returning the list of those symbols. So that's all we need to do for this one. Let's see how it goes. We completed the task. Awesome. So if you notice in the background here, the equity curve is flat. So what we were doing, we were saying that if the indicators aren't ready to use, then we shouldn't add them to the selected list. So it looks like none of the indicators were ready to use. So we're going to address that in the next task. Because it's a 200-day EMA, it takes a long time for those EMAs to be ready to use. So this is a perfect application for history. You can then go and ask for the historical data of that asset, and then update the indicators using the historical data so that your algorithm can be trading immediately when you deploy it. So the history API you can see here, we can just ask for 200 bars, or in this case days, of this particular symbol, and we can create this object here. And so this will give us those 200 bars of that asset. Okay, so now that we have the history object, the collection of bars for that asset, let's pass it into our selection data class so that we can start preparing our indicators. So we can take this here and pass it into selection data. And now we need to make sure the selection data class can receive that history object. So we can come here and update the constructor. So now we're going to be receiving that history object into our selection data class. There are a million different ways you can warm up these indicators, but this particular way simply passes in the minimum data that the object needs and maintains a nice code cleanliness. So finally, now we have the history object, we need to loop over its results and update the indicators. So we can use this example code here. And using this, we're going to be iterating the tuples. So we're using a pandas method here, iter tuples, and it's going to return a bar. And the index of that is the time. And then the close property here is the close of that day. So you can see an example here on the left. You can see the printed format of the historical data with the time and the close. So we're going to be iterating each of those rows and updating the time and then the close. And so if we do that to both indicators, then the indicators should be ready to trade when we do the universe selection. So let's do a last check. We're calling history to get the 200 days. We're adjusting the method here to take in the historical object. And then we're updating the constructor, the init method here, to take that historical data. And then we're updating those indicators with that price data. So let's see how it goes. Awesome, looks like we passed the task. If you notice in the background, you can see the chart is plotting here immediately from when we deployed the algorithm. So that means that our history call worked and our indicators have been updated and are ready to trade. Congratulations, and I look forward to seeing you in the next task.